put up my fingertips, kiss the sky with crimson lips. I wanna fly high with you, wrote a book with my burning bricks, hit the night like a rocket ship. I wanna hide away from you. I feel the love I've been in pain.
Welcome to this James Cook University graduation ceremony. Please ensure that all electronic devices are switched off. Graduates, you are reminded that protocol requires that you take off your mortarboard bonnet for the national anthem. Would the assembly please stand for the entrance of the academic procession?
Chancellor, Vice Chancellor and President, Deputy Chancellor, members of the official party, member of the University Council, members of staff, distinguished guests, graduates and guests. Good evening and welcome to this graduation ceremony for the College of Arts, Society and Education. Would you please remain standing for the national anthem, which will be sung by Miss Andrea Alame. Assembly, please be seated. Professor Martin Nakata, Member of the Order of Australia and Pro Vice Chancellor Indigenous Education and Strategy, will now present a pre-recorded acknowledgement to country.
James Cook University has a long-standing tradition in acknowledging and paying respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who have occupied Australia for 60,000 years. Indigenous people's relationship to their countries and seas rests on the understanding that the earth is our mother the mother that gave birth to us all and provides for us every day. The knowledge accumulated by Indigenous Australians over millennia should speak to us all about the importance of human respect and responsibility for the land and seas on which all our lives and those of future generations still depend. James Cook University takes great pride in this important part of our Australian heritage. And as graduates of this university, I sincerely hope that you will carry this understanding forward throughout your lives. Thank you, and congratulations on your achievements.
We are assembled here today to confer James Cook University degrees and awards. May I take this opportunity to introduce members of the official party. My name is Mr. Russ Parker, and I am the marshal for today's ceremony. From my right, Professor Anne-Marie Morgan, Dean of the College of Arts, Society and Education. Professor Christine Bruce, Dean of Graduate Research. Member of the University Council, Dr. Jonathan Strauss. Deputy University Secretary and today's Mace Bearer, Ms. Giselle Bovink. The University's Chancellor, Mr. Bill Twiddell. Vice-Chancellor and President, Professor Sandra Harding, Officer of the Order of Australia. Deputy Chancellor, Mr. Peter Phillips. Dr. David Craig, Director of the Cairns Campus. And Professor Stephen Naylor, Chair of the University's Academic Board. Seated behind the official party are members of the university staff. Chancellor, I invite you to address the Assembly.
Good evening. I warmly acknowledge tonight Professor Sandra Harding, AO, our Vice-Chancellor and President, Mr. Peter Phillips, our Deputy Chancellor, Ms. Andrea Della Mattea, our distinguished occasional speaker. Andrea has a remarkably successful professional career, as you'll see, and a very strong connection with James Cook University as one of our outstanding alumni and as a member of our Singapore Campus Advisory Board. Andrea is based in Singapore, and we are very grateful she was able to produce and record an address for us, which will be played later on. I acknowledge too Alex Myhill, our outstanding graduate speaker, who has also recorded a heartwarming message for us. Alex's academic prowess was apparent from a very young age. In fact, he started at just 15 his studies for a Bachelor of Science degree at James Cook University. Dr. Jonathan Strauss and other members of the James Cook University governing body, the Council, members of the official party, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, parents, and above all else, you, our graduating students. A big thank you also to Professor Martin Nakata, AM, another of JCU's outstanding alumni, for his warm and evocative acknowledgement to country. Martin has made and continues to make a very significant contribution to Indigenous education. James Cook University conducts its business on the lands and the seas of many of Australia's First Nations people, and it's therefore with gratitude that I also acknowledge the traditional owners of those lands and seas, their rich cultures, and their unique knowledge of our natural environment, and the past, present, and future contributions which Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities make to the broader fortunes of our community. Warm thanks also to Andrea Alumei for her stirring rendition of our national anthem and for her excellent pre-ceremony entertainment. Ladies and gentlemen, there are many good aspects of being Chancellor of my alma mater. One of the very best is presiding at graduation ceremonies. That's because at these ceremonies I get to see the pride and achievement in the eyes and in the smiles of our terrific graduates and also of their loved ones. I also have a chance to rejoice with the wonderful staff of James Cook University at the culmination of all their work to turn out graduates of such remarkable quality. 2020 was, by any standards, a tough year, with COVID-19 altering fundamental aspects of our lives and bringing devastation and disruption to our world. So many have suffered loss and continue to do so because of the pandemic. At JCU, the pandemic prompted a fundamental rethinking and rejigging of how we go about our business. The way our JCU community responded at all levels was nothing short of outstanding and a heartening affirmation of what we can achieve when we all pull together and support each other. 2020 was also, of course, our university's 50th anniversary year, and as a result of COVID-19 restrictions, many of the planned celebrations, along with our graduation ceremonies, had to be cancelled or postponed, or celebrated in virtual ways rather than in person. All this meant that we were unable to give many of our students the live graduation ceremony that you all so richly deserve. Happily, that situation has changed, and the time-honoured tradition of gathering together with your graduating cohort, along with family and friends, and marking the occasion with ceremony and applause, has arrived, and we have the opportunity to honour you and to celebrate your successes. So I take great pleasure in welcoming you, our graduating students, and in congratulating you on your achievements. In doing so, I'm sure you'd be the first to want me to also acknowledge with gratitude the family and friends whose love and support have helped bring you to this milestone in your lives. Ladies and gentlemen, a brief note about something you will notice later in our ceremony. James Cook University is always proud to celebrate the diversity of cultures and customs that make up our university community and landscape. So it is very special for us to acknowledge the academic achievements of our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students through a sassing ceremony that we hold just before each graduation ceremony, including this one. You will see those First Nations students proudly wearing their sashes today as they come across the stage to receive their awards. We were particularly proud to announce late last year that local First Nations communities had gifted to us Indigenous names for each of JCU's campuses in northern Queensland. At a personal level, I was very proud indeed to participate in these ceremonies and to acknowledge the role of First Nations peoples in the advancement of the university as part of our 50th birthday celebrations. As we embark upon the next 50 years together, James Cook University's relationship with First Nations communities will remain a central focus of our commitment and of our endeavour. Ladies and gentlemen, on the 20th of April this year, just next week, we wrap up our 50th anniversary year. It will have been half a century since the Queen signed in person the act which created James Cook University. That was quite literally a unique occasion in history, the only time a reigning monarch had done such a thing. My wife, Chris, and I, and Chris is here with us tonight, were both proud to be present on that occasion. Last year, we also celebrated 60 years of providing higher education in North Queensland. These days, ladies and gentlemen, ceremonies like graduation ceremonies are dignified and relatively formal events. It seems it wasn't always so. One of our observant JCU staff recently drew my attention to a report that during the speeches at the opening of the University College of Townsville in 1961, the audience gained their first experience of university student pranks. During the official speeches on that auspicious occasion, students thought it would be a good idea to lower a dog and then a cat from the top of a building right near where the speeches were being made. Students also let off a single loud firecracker nearby. The audience, it seems from the records, was pretty puzzled by all this. So I'm relieved to look out on a sea of faces of today's much better behaved generation of JCU students, and to feel relief that you are so much better behaved, particularly when we're live streaming this event. A lot has certainly changed over the decades, and JCU has played a part in many positive developments in our immediate region and across the tropics in fulfilment of our truly visionary mandate to be Australia's university for the tropics. JCU has grown to be a world leader in education and research on the tropics. We are ranked in the top 201 to 250 universities worldwide in the 2021 Times Higher Education World University Rankings, and the top 400 universities globally in the academic ranking of world universities for 2020. We are ranked number one in the world for marine and freshwater biology, and number two in the world for biodiversity conservation by the respected Centre for World University Rankings. We are also the only Queensland university and one of only three Australian universities to receive a five-star rating for graduate employment outcomes for the past 10 years in a row, according to the authoritative Good Universities Guide. Over the years, we've become a vibrant, multi-campus university, a long way from the humbler infant institution at which I commenced studies in 1968. In our 50 years as JCU, over 50,000 graduates have proven the success of the JCU approach to teaching, learning, and research. Our graduates have made significant contributions everywhere we look, playing vital roles in business, education, as diplomats, vice chancellors, politicians, law enforcement officers, health professionals, community leaders, and chief executives. The point I'm making is that in graduating today, you are joining the ranks of some very high-achieving JCU alumni. Let me name just a few. 2016 JCU Outstanding Alumnus and Cairns-based former Senator Jan McLucas. Born on the Atherton Tableland, Jan attended the local primary school at Ravenshoe and graduated with a Diploma of Teaching from the Townsville College of Advanced Education, as it was then, now JCU. Dr. Cathy Day, one of the most innovative education leaders in Queensland, who was recognised in 2011 as one of JCU's outstanding alumni. The former Vice-Chancellor of Queensland University of Technology, among other roles, Emeritus Professor Peter Coldrake AO, who graduated with a Bachelor of Arts with Honours in 1973 and has gone on to a very distinguished career in higher education. The author and Queensland Magistrate, Cathy McLennan, is one of our graduates. Miss Winsome Denyer, award-winning journalist with The Australian Story and 2012 JCU Outstanding Alumni Awardee. Emeritus Professor Clive Moore, 2012 Outstanding Alumnus and former head of the School of History, Philosophy and Religion and Classics at the University of Queensland. The Mareeba Shire Council Mayor and former Cairns State High School Principal, Councillor Angela Toppin, who was a JCU alumna and is also, in fact, a member of the JCU Council that I chair. And Australia's Ambassador for Gender Equality and former Ambassador to Spain, Julianne Guevara, a Torres Strait Islander who was the first Indigenous officer of the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade to be promoted to the Senior Executive Service, an important milestone in Australia's diplomatic history. I could go on and on with impressive examples of those who have gone before you as JCU graduates making a mark in the world. I'm sure you'll be relieved to know I won't. I'll let those few examples illustrate my point. Ladies and gentlemen, especially given that Chris and I are both graduates of JCU, a very special and pleasant aspect of my role today is to welcome you all, JCU's new graduates, to our alumni family. One of the most uplifting of my roles as Chancellor is seeing you come across the stage to receive your awards. That will be the time for your family, your friends, your supporters to applaud and to cheer you with all the gusto and energy they can muster. But please, no firecrackers. So wherever you are in the world, our graduates, please do keep in touch with JCU. Chris and I are so glad we did. We and many others look forward to hearing of your adventures and successes in the future. Thank you very much.
Chancellor, I invite the Chair of the Academic Board, Professor Stephen Naylor, to present the graduating students.
Would all graduating students please stand? Chancellor, I certify to you and to the university that all graduating students who stand before you today have fulfilled the requirements prescribed by the university, and I ask that they be acknowledged as having been admitted to their respective awards.
In the name of the University Council and by my authority as Chancellor, I acknowledge candidates so approved and congratulate and warmly welcome you as James Cook University alumni.
Would all graduates please be seated?
Chancellor, the James Cook University Professional Doctorate, the Doctor of Education, is a professional doctorate by research. It offers advanced study for experienced professionals in education and related fields and caters for people in or aspiring to leadership roles in educational settings. A substantive research dissertation is completed as part of the program. One graduate is to be presented this morning. My apologies, this evening. Professor Anne-Marie Morgan, Dean of the College of Arts, Society and Education, will present the graduate, and Professor Stephen Naylor, Chairperson of the Academic Board, will read the graduate's thesis abstract.
Dr. Gerges's studies were undertaken in the discipline of teacher education under the supervision of Associate Professor Hilary Whitehouse and Dr. Clifford Jackson.
Chancellor, Dr. Gerges's research explored the way adults are trained in the workplace in workplace safety and health, using the world's best practices. It was discovered that adults were not trained to a high standard. Improving the way adults are trained in the workplace safety and health reduces injuries and fatalities in the workplace. Chancellor, I present Dr. Gerges.
Chancellor, this concludes the presentation of the Doctor of Education Award.
Chancellor, a Doctor of Philosophy degree takes a special place in our graduation ceremonies. It is one of the highest qualifications that the university awards. This degree is awarded for the successful completion of a significant piece of independent research, sustained in its scholarly character, and one which makes an original contribution to the field. External examination is always involved. 9 candidates will be presented this evening. Professor Christine Bruce, Dean of Graduate Research, will present the graduates, and Professor Stephen Naylor, Chair of the Academic Board, will read the thesis abstracts.
Matthew Buttercavoli. Dr. Buttercavoli's studies were undertaken in the discipline of anthropology under the supervision of Associate Professor Jennifer Dager and Professor Ton Otto.
Chancellor, Dr. Buttercavoli studied the development and detection of underwater noise pollution in the Great Barrier Reef. He examined the phenomena of using multi-species ethnographic approach. He found that the characteristics of animals and species boundaries that make sensing underwater noise difficult can be overcome through technology and skilled practice. Dr. Buttercavoli was awarded the Dean's Award for Excellence. Chancellor, I present Dr. Buttercavoli.
Karen Cheer. Dr. Cheer's studies were undertaken in the discipline of society and culture under the supervision of Professor Komla Tsai, Associate Professor David McLaren, and Dr. Jennifer Kelly.
Chancellor, Dr. Cheer studied midwifery students' experiences in providing care to women following stillbirth in Papua New Guinea. She found that midwifery students balanced social, cultural, spiritual, and professional factors to provide the best possible care. The results of her study are informing midwifery education and practice in Papua New Guinea. Dr. Cheer's thesis was judged by two examiners to be outstanding in an international ranking and was passed cum laude, which is Latin for in praise or honour. Chancellor, I present Dr. Cheer.
Françoise-Marie Danielle Dacan. Dr. Dacan's studies were undertaken in the discipline of history under the supervision of Dr. Janice Wegner, Dr. Claire Brennan, and distinguished Professor Sasha Aikenwald.
Chancellor, Dr. Dacan critically studied the work of 18th century French feminist Madame de Staël to demonstrate the link between feminism and abolitionism in her literature. A close analysis reveals that the link between these two ideologies has been underestimated in the past, as has the modernity of her writing. Chancellor, I present Dr. Daquin.
Galena William John Elwood. Dr. Elwood's studies were undertaken in the discipline of cultural heritage studies under the supervision of Dr. Janice Wegner and Dr. Mike Wood.
Chancellor, Dr. Elwood researched the history of Aboriginal prospecting and mining in North Queensland, 1860 to 1960. He found that Aborigines who were already miners in pre-contact society were involved in and important for the industry. They have been forgotten and written out of history, and his thesis rescues their stories. Dr. Elwood's thesis was judged by two examiners to be outstanding in an international ranking and was passed cum laude, which is of course Latin for with praise or honour. Chancellor, I present Dr. Elwood.
Gary Page Jones. Dr. Jones' studies were undertaken in the discipline of sociology under the supervision of Professor Komla Tsai and Associate Professor Deborah Graham.
Chancellor, Dr. Jones studied processes of managing HIV amongst young people in two slum areas in Kenya. He found that perceptions of risk and associated behaviour emphasised the integrity of proactive and assertive action. The significance of his study is informing the need to develop youth-centred and decentralised healthcare systems. Chancellor, I present Dr. Jones.
Professor Emma Caitlin Rain. Dr. Rain's studies were undertaken in the discipline of archaeology under the supervision of Distinguished Professor Michael Bird, Distinguished Professor Sean Ulm, and Dr. Cassandra Rowe.
Chancellor, Dr. Rain studied the fire history of three wetlands and the savannas of northern Australia over 1,000 years. She found that fire incidence and intensity varied greatly in each site, related to climate and humans. The methods developed in her study will improve future research reconstruction of past fire records. Chancellor, I present Dr. Rin.
Sandra Elizabeth Robb. Dr. Robb's studies were undertaken in the discipline of history under the supervision of Dr. Janice Wegner and Professor Richard Nile.
Chancellor, Dr. Robb outlined the Chinese family landscape, which developed across North Queensland in the 19th and early 20th centuries. Her research highlights the role of women and family played in the Chinese diaspora. She statistically and geographically maps the presence of women in urban, regional and remote communities, enabling new understandings and interpretations of Queensland's Chinese experience to emerge. Chancellor, I present Dr. Robb.
Nicholas Duke Roberts. Dr. Roberts' studies were undertaken in the discipline of anthropology under the supervision of Dr. Nigel Chang, Professor Rosita Henry, Dr. Robin Rodd, and Dr. Mark Chong.
Chancellor, Dr. Roberts examined the heritage value of caves located with the Sepon Gold and Copper Mine in the Lao People's Democratic Republic. He found that caves retain a variety of significant past, present and future orientated heritage, uses and values. However, mining context presents opportunities and challenges which complicate sustainable management of caves as heritage places. Chancellor, I present Dr. Roberts.
Rosalie Joyce Shepherd. Dr. Shepherd's studies were undertaken in the discipline of history under the supervision of Dr. Janice Wegner and Associate Professor Russell McGregor.
Chancellor, Dr. Shepherd examined the history of cultural landscape change in the Red Lynch Valley. She found that attitudes to white people in the tropics and legislation under the White Australian Policy largely influenced the evolving landscape. Her research acknowledged the neglected role of women in the history of the area. Chancellor, I present Dr. Shepherd.
Chancellor, some advisors and academic friends who have worked closely with our graduate researchers are with us today. I invite them to stand in acknowledgement of these fine achievements. Chancellor, this concludes the presentation of Doctor of Philosophy graduates.
Chancellor, in recognition of academic excellence, the university bestows an award to graduates whose doctoral research theses have been passed cum laude. I am pleased to announce that a Medal for Excellence for two doctoral research theses is to be awarded to graduates so honoured. I call upon the Chairperson of the Academic Board, Professor Stephen Naylor, to present the recipients.
Chancellor, I present graduates so honoured, Dr. Karen Diane Chia. Dr. Galena William John Elwood. Chancellor, this concludes the presentation of medals of excellence for doctoral research thesis.
Chancellor, I invite Professor Anne-Marie Morgan, Dean of the College of Arts, Society and Education, to present the college graduates.
Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Education. Emma Nicole Auld. Oliver Clancy Boswell. Katie Elizabeth Bray. Sharon Marie Brown. Hannah Felicity Jane Brekovich. The George Herring Prize in Education, Emily Alice Caffera. Joshua Andrew Coleman. Gemma Cherie Carson. Kate Mary Chapman. Talesha Marie Chirani. Alex Thomas Collins. Christine Roslyn Darcy. Joanna Rose Delaney. Jonai Patrice Downing. Nikia Megan Duncan. Manraj Singh Guman. Julia Monique Glisson. Jacqueline Melanie Gorgip. Genevieve Hevesy. Emily Rose Height. Lauren Kiaora Hutchison. Karen Ann Larson. Kira Rochelle McLeod. Priscilla Suzanne Madden. Sarifa Mali. The Academic Medal Bachelor Coursework, Kayla Ann Marino. Chelsea Lee Mason Blackwell. Georgia Elise McBain. Ashton Paige McCormick. Zoe Caitlin McDermott. Evelyn Ann McInnes. Jane Ostler. Sarah Denny Poggioli. Alex Riches. Catherine Kayla Rossi. Chloe Sue Rutledge. Sophie Jane Ryan. Emma Jane Sanderlant. Duncan Seedon. Eleanor Louise Silver. Lee William Slatcher. Chantal Francis Stanton. Anthea Riley Stevens. Chantel Timpany. Andre Vivian Peter Van Sluten. Angus Van Walton. Madeline Elise Wells. Nathan Robert Zara. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Education with distinction. Caitlin Joan Buckley. Hayley Margaret Flatman. Still the same one. Randeep Kaur Johal. Bradley John Graham. Sarah Louise Reed. Elise Meredith Selden. Adriana Sonchin. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Educational Services, Jack Spencer Wilkinson. Chancellor, I present a graduate admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Social Science, Doran Susan Kaisanga. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Social Work, Jamie Lee Arwang. Zoe Louise Armstrong. Albert Bizumir Emi. Lara J. Burgett. Jennifer Lynn Borghero. Luke Philip Casper. Hui Ying Lydia Chung. Rebecca Dath Weston. Belinda Lee Denyer. Crystal June Dallahide. Daniel Lee Einberg. Evie Francis. Tracy Ann Gray. Melanie Ann Heron. Jolie Violet Hunt. Rebecca Jade Johnson. Gemma Elizabeth Joseph. Anika Kaur. Cassandra Frieda Irene Lee. Kia Ann McDowell. Colin Patrick Morris. Kathleen Lorena. Rebecca Therese Linklater. Mei Chow Moa. The Rick Thompson Inclusion Award, Sanduni Nananyakara. Bobby Perkins. Jessica Inda Russell. Monique Elizabeth Satrick. Marianne Rachel Savage. Alexandria Michelle Simcock. Alison Marion Sliney. Michelle Kelly Smith. Elizabeth Thade. Stacey Thomas. Brooke White. Chancellor, I present a graduate admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Social Work with Distinction, the Social Work and Human Services Prize, Katie Lynn Ann Drysdale. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Bachelor of Social Work Honours, Taryn Marie Curtin. Kerry Ann Murphy. The Social Work and Human Services Prize, Rachel Lee Wilson. Simone Marie Dewar. Chancellor, I present graduates awarded the degree of Graduate Certificate of Education, Maria Ann Liston. Dr. Dilip Sharma. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Education, Loretta Ann Kishihara. Amanda Jane Saunders. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Education with Distinction, Michelle Ann Hodgkiss. Jacqueline Alexandra Jackson. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Guidance and Counselling, Yvonne Anki Powerlit. Lindsay Russell. Erna Desiree Spigariol. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Teaching and Learning, Marie K. Giles. Mark Lawrence Malone. Dean John McGilvray. Tyler Josh Tranter. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Teaching and Learning with Distinction, Astrid Lee Baker. Jennifer Helen Edney. Chancellor, I present graduates admitted to the degree of Master of Teaching and Learning, Madeline K. Benedetti. Chandip Kaur. Emma Louise Klein. Jack Robert Wyatt. Chancellor, I present a graduate admitted to the degree of Master of Philosophy, Creative Arts, Karen Ann Argus. Chancellor, this concludes the presentation of the College of Arts, Society and Education Awards.
Chancellor, I have the pleasure in introducing today's occasional speaker, Ms. Andrea Della Mattea. Ms. Della Mattea is the President of Microsoft Asia Pacific, whose mission is to empower every person and every organisation on the planet to achieve more. Ms. Della Mattea has more than 25 years' experience in the technology sector. A student of James Cook University between 1989 and 1992, Ms. Della Mattea received her Bachelor of Engineering Computer Systems degree with Class 1 honours in 1993. Ms. Della Mattea is also a graduate member of the Australian Institute of Company Directors, and currently serves on the Board of Directors for Meals on Wheels New South Wales, the Advisory Board for Habitat for Humanity Australia, and the James Cook University Singapore Advisory Board. Ms. Della Mattea was awarded an Outstanding Alumni Award in 2010 and currently resides in Singapore with her husband and two sons. Due to the current international travel restrictions, Ms. Della Mattea's address has been pre-recorded. Chancellor, Ms. Andrea Della Mattea.
Chancellor, Vice-Chancellor and President, members of Council, members of staff, ladies and gentlemen, and of course, JCU graduates. I'm incredibly honoured to be here with you today to celebrate you and your achievements. Now, who would have ever imagined that a global pandemic would impact the world as it did? And yet, thanks to the incredible team at James Cook University, and technology, of course, we all have the opportunity to be here with you today to celebrate you. Now, I've no doubt when you look back and you reflect upon the prior years, you're probably filled with some mixed emotions. On the first day, that sense of excitement starting out on your degree, meeting new students, some from other cities or other countries, many of whom may become your lifelong friends, others who might become a future business partner if you have dreams of starting your own organisation to make a difference in the world. And of course, today, your graduation day, that sense of achievement, finally completing your degree. You know, when I look back and reflect upon my time at James Cook, I have so many incredible memories. But what I remember most vividly is the look in my parents' eyes. They were so proud of me, of my achievements, and they were so excited to see me graduate. And I simply could not have made it through my degree without their support. James Cook wasn't close to where I lived, and back then, in the 90s, we didn't have Snapchat, Instagram, or TikTok, and yet I always knew my parents had my back, and they were there for me when I needed them, through the good times and the bad. And let's face it, there certainly were some tough days. Now, for some of you graduating today, you may know that same feeling. So I'd like to take a moment to thank and recognise the parents, family members and friends who are here today to celebrate our graduates. Thank you for your unwavering support and guidance for our graduates. It's the advice you give, the values that you impart, that have helped shape and influence who our graduates are today. And you should be incredibly proud because today is as much about you as it is our graduates. And now to our James Cook graduates, a hearty congratulations. You've made it to graduation. And you're graduating from an incredible university where people are making a difference to create a brighter future for life in the tropics. Okay, so now that you've graduated, what's next? Where to from here now, right? When Professor Harding first invited me to give the occasional address, I had to stop and think, what would be of interest to share with you? I've had so many learnings since I graduated back in 1993, so I asked myself, what would I have loved to know back then on my graduation day? And I've decided to share three learnings with you. And the first is to follow your passion. Find something you believe in. Find something that you feel strongly about to pay it forward and give back to somebody else. When I studied engineering, it was a time when there were very few females studying engineering, and there were very few females in the engineering industry. And that's one of the reasons I'm so passionate about spending time with young female students in high school and university, encouraging them to pursue STEM. And I feel really humbled that I'm invited to speak with young female students. I remember fondly how I spent International Women's Day one year with 500 young female high school students in Sri Lanka. Those girls just blew me away with their hopes and dreams, and big hopes and dreams. One young girl wanted to develop an app to help people with depression. And another young girl wanted to develop an app to help better educate youths in remote locations. Their stories were just so inspirational and so powerful. And I feel really humbled where I'm in a position that I can give back and I can balance my personal passion with my professional career. And that leads me to my second piece of advice. I encourage you to find people who believe in you and your potential. You know, in your life, You will meet people who may not believe in you and your potential. They'll be the naysayers and the critics. Do not let them define who you are. Only you can define who you are. And I encourage you to be the very best version of you that you can possibly imagine. I was very fortunate early on in my career to interview with a young tech entrepreneur. And I still remember as I was preparing for the interview, I was ready to talk about my history, my results, what I had achieved. And yet the young entrepreneur wanted to focus on my future and what I wanted to do, my aspirations. And in hindsight, looking back, he saw something in me, and that was my potential. When you work with someone who believes in you and your potential, they give you the opportunity to learn, to take a risk, to fail, and to grow. You know, we all have unlimited potential, but it takes real courage to realize that potential and to be fearless. Lastly, I encourage you to go out there and change the world. The world desperately needs you, now more than ever. Young, hopeful, fearless, passionate people. You know, there are many ways to make money out there, but at the end of the day, all you'll have is money. If you strive to make a difference in this world, then you'll have lived a life worth living. I'm really fortunate that I have the opportunity to work with an organization that supports and encourages me to do just that. At Microsoft, our mission is to empower every person and every organization on the planet to achieve more. And that's what inspires me. It's knowing that every day we're making a difference. We're helping young girls in Sri Lanka to beat the odds. We're helping entrepreneurs to fulfill their dreams, and we're empowering the planet. So I encourage you, go out there and change the world. Leave your mark in the sand. Think about the difference that you want to make. And with that, I'd like to congratulate you again on your graduation day and wish you all the very best for success. Cheers.
Chancellor, outstanding graduate Mr. Alex Myhill will now present the 2021 graduate address. Mr. Myhill's address has also been pre-recorded.
Chancellor, Vice-Chancellor and President, members of Council, members of staff, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, fellow graduates. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of my fellow graduates to Ms. Andrea Della Mattia, today's occasional speaker. I am certain that I speak for us all when I say that we are inspired and empowered by the eloquent words of this outstanding JCU alumni. Ms. Andrea Della Mattia, your experience and wisdom reflected in your speech today places before us a lofty goal. Your reminder to us of the opportunities that await in the modern world, as well as the pitfalls, is invaluable. It is incumbent on all of us graduates assembled here today to reflect on and aspire to put into practice your words of inspiration from this day forward. Chancellor, on behalf of today's graduates, would you please pass on our thanks and gratitude to Ms. Andrea Della Mattia. Having reached this milestone of celebrating our achievements at today's ceremony, it is important to acknowledge the journey that we have all undergone. Everyone graduating today has had a different pathway to this point. Some of us came straight from school. Others took a leap of faith after a period in the workforce. There are several common factors, however, that bind us together. The first is the support of our parents, family, and friends. Tertiary education, whilst exciting and uplifting, can be very demanding and stressful. Throughout the journey that we have taken, these great people have shared in our successes, comforted us in our failings, acted as our confidants when we questioned our own abilities, and for some, been a shoulder to cry on. You have enriched our lives and enabled our journey of growth and learning. You have and deserve our eternal gratitude and, dare I say it, you can finally breathe a sigh of relief on our behalf. Graduates, please stand and turn towards your family and friends here today and join me in a vigorous round of applause. Graduates, please be seated. Another common factor that binds us all together is the staff that we have learned from. Physics tells us that getting information out of a black hole is not possible. Thankfully, we haven't needed to do that. Your dedication, professionalism, and knowledge and passion are examples for us all to follow. The lecturers, tutors, and research staff have implanted within us the seed of knowledge and laid it in the hopefully fertile soil that it deserves. Our gratitude cannot be overstated. If we ever are able to see further than you, it will be because of your vision and commitment. Finally, what binds us, the 2019 and 2020 graduates assembled here today, is the fact that we have completed our degrees. Congratulations to us all. It is a momentous occasion. Through the highs and the lows, we have persevered to get to this point. We have learned that to succeed is not to be a success, but more importantly, that to fail is not to be a failure. As Churchill stated, success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. We have gained this resilience through our experience, and we will continue to require this trait for the rest of our lives. I would like to conclude with a brief glance at history. We are the beneficiaries of an inheritance that must be treasured, an inheritance that extends back to the great scholars of antiquity, that encompasses the Eastern and Western intellectual traditions, culture, and music. It is an inheritance that includes the men and women of the Renaissance and the great figures of the last century, and prefigures and postdates the dawn of rigorous science and medicine, and the explosion of art and music. These factors exemplify the pursuit of knowledge and the refinement of culture that are universal to all humankind. These are the ultimate ties that bind. This is our torch to bear throughout life. It is our role to never let the flame of curiosity and the fire of discovery and the spark of creativity die. Let this day, therefore, not be the end of our journey, but merely the start. God bless our family and the staff who made this day possible. And God bless everyone who will graduate today. Let us guard this inheritance with jealousy. And maybe we will see a little further than the giants whose shoulders we stand upon. Thank you, and congratulations to us all.
Chancellor, I now have the pleasure of inviting Vice-Chancellor and President, Professor Sandra Harding, to deliver the closing address.
Chancellor, Deputy Chancellor, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, children, my university colleagues, and most of all, graduates. I am here to congratulate you, our graduates, and I do so most warmly and sincerely. You have achieved something important, really something mighty, by being here today. You have stayed the course and met the requirements of your degree program, and you enter the world in a new way, as a graduate, a James Cook University graduate, now a member of the JCU alumni. You deserve my very best congratulations and those of everyone in this auditorium. We celebrate you and we honour you. Well done, graduates, well done. Second, I too acknowledge and congratulate your parents, partners, family, friends and supporters, many here and the many more who are thinking of you from afar. As you walked across the stage, the pride of those here, their pride in you and what you have achieved, was obvious. On a day like this, a day that can seem like it's all about you, I hope you will take a moment to think about them. In many ways, your parents' or carers' job over many years, from the time you were born, has been to practice letting you go, certainly to love you, to help you, to guide you, and to provide what they could for you, but ultimately their job is to let you go, to become your own person. Until you become a parent or grandparent or carer, you cannot know what this letting go is like. Watching you grow and achieve, seeing you struggle and succeed, and not knowing how or if they can help, while hoping you make choices worthy of you. That watching is joyful and hard and sad and wonderful all at once. Your other family members, your friends and supporters have had a similar job, to be there with you and for you, to help you along your way as best they can, but to let you be who you are and who you want to be. Graduates, my point is that this letting go is a very difficult task, and all these people here today or thinking of you from afar who have loved and supported you as long as they have known you, they deserve my best congratulations for all they have done for you, and they deserve yours too. Once this ceremony is concluded, please take a moment to tell them so, for surely you wouldn't be here without them. Strangely, perhaps, the job of your professors and lecturers and the professional and technical staff of the university is rather the same as those others we acknowledge today. While our engagement with you hasn't been for as long, we too have watched you develop, and our job has been to guide and to help you as you work towards achieving your qualification. So I congratulate and thank my university colleagues for the important role they have played on your educational journey. Know that we're here to help you as best we can, but we are also in the business of letting you go to develop and grow from here. Now, with thanks delivered, you might think that my job in this ceremony is done. Not so. My job is to give you the last word from the university, and that last word, in just a few moments more, focuses on you and on what happens from here. The late 1990s movie Sliding Doors, starring Gwyneth Paltrow, explored the consequences of making a particular choice. The central idea is that the choices we make at any moment will take us in one direction, whereas a different choice made at that same moment might have very different life consequences. It wasn't a great movie, and far from a startling box office success, but that central idea about the possibility of different lives lived as a result of our choices is intriguing, and it rings true for many of us. Graduates, in the spirit of letting you go, it is your choices from here that I want to speak with you about. I put it to you that today, as you sit here, and for the rest of your professional life, there are two critical questions facing you. How you choose to respond to them is up to you and you alone. Taken together, your response, what you choose, will determine your life's course. Here's the first question. Can you do what needs to be done? Can you do what needs to be done? Now, answering this question might seem easy. Each and every one of you has already shown that you are capable and can do what needs to be done. While working towards achieving your goal of completing your degree program, you were tested, you endured, you succeeded. You wouldn't be here otherwise, the very centre of this celebration. But there's another side to this question. As a new graduate, can you do what needs to be done from here as a professional in this world? While a good income and community esteem are often linked to professional practice, it is service that lies at the heart of being a professional. Indeed, all professions serve others in one way or another. Some have legal obligations to do so. This means that while you now have a solid knowledge and skills base to practice your profession, with your degree proof of that, more is required of you. In order to do what needs to be done, in order to serve as a professional, you will need to build on that base throughout your career. You will need to make learning and development your constant companion. This is vital. As you practice your profession, others will be relying on your up-to-date skills and knowledge, on your advice and expertise. Often those others will need your utmost attention and effort, your utmost professionalism, in a moment when they may be vulnerable or questioning or don't know what to do, relying on you to help them to understand, to guide their action to do or to be better. Meeting the needs of others, your service, requires that you commit to growing your knowledge and skills, your understanding and expertise. So my first question is, can you do this? Can you do what needs to be done to serve as a professional in this world? Graduates, I don't doubt, and I expect that no one here in this auditorium today doubts that you can do this, that you can do what needs to be done if you choose. But here's my second question. Graduates, will you do what needs to be done? Will you do what needs to be done? If your professional life from here is like most others, most of your days will be fairly routine. You will grow your capability and your understanding of your profession. You will serve. You may even become a leader in your field whom other professionals look to for guidance and advice. On those routine days, you will meet others' needs as required, and you will practice your profession by simply getting on with the job that you've committed to do. But graduates, there is nothing surer than this. From time to time, among these many routine days, there will be days of extraordinary intensity and hard choices. At those times, despite all your commitment to learning and growing your knowledge and expertise, despite all your experience and understanding, there will be moments when you are truly tested, tested to a point where you feel you don't know, where it all seems too hard. There will be times when you must choose between what others need and what you want. There will be times when you must choose between an easy path and the right path. What you choose to do at these times, these most difficult of times, that will come to you as they do to us all, is full of meaning for those who are depending on you and for you as a professional and as a person. It is in these moments that you will need to find strength and courage. Graduates, you will need to find your will to do what needs to be done. Making the choice to do what needs to be done when it is hard and you would rather not, when you yourself might be criticised or feel at risk, will test your strength and your courage. Making the choice to do what needs to be done in these moments will test your honesty and your humility. It will test your ethics and your integrity. It will test your worth as a professional. But most of all, making the choice to do what needs to be done will test who you really are and who you have become. Your choice at those moments, and those moments will come to you, your choice at those most difficult moments will define you as a professional and as a human being in this world. Graduates, your parents, friends, loved ones and supporters chose to do all they could for you, and they choose to let you go, to be your own person, to write your own script in this world. By means of their love and support for you, they have chosen you and all your promise. And here they are again, in this place, or thinking of you from afar. As hard as it is, they are doing their best to let you go, to make your own choices from here, for you to decide what sort of professional what sort of person you will become. Now, and there's no putting this off right now, it is time for you to choose. Will you commit to doing what needs to be done, easy or not, whether you want to or not? Will you make this choice, this solemn vow to yourself, to those who love you and care for you, and to the many others you have not yet met, but who will be depending on you? Will you do this and set your life's course to become the professional, to become the person you were always meant to be? Graduates, I urge you to think deeply on this. If you can make this choice, if you will commit to doing what needs to be done, know this: the world will be a better place for you having lived in it. Graduates, choose wisely. Goodbye and good luck.
Chancellor, the successful staging of this ceremony is the culminative effort of many university and venue staff. I would like to thank the University Ceremonies and Examination Officers and the management and staff of the Cairns Performing Arts Centre for the staging of this ceremony. This graduation ceremony is now concluded. Graduates and guests, please observe COVID-safe distancing practices as you exit the venue. Will the Assembly please stand as the Chancellor leads the academic procession from the stage?